Is that microphone for clipping on, or is it just standing here? I'll just get some water while
you do that. I might send an email to Tristan.
I didn't even realize there wasn't a microphone in here. I was talking here and you with that.
Did you?
Yeah, I didn't know.
Oh, the volunteer is supposed to tell you to use this thing because it's this thing because it's being recorded. Anything? Is it working?
Yay. I don't know what I did other than tap it, which you're not supposed to do, but. Mm-hmm. So do I clip that on or?
The more you keep together, the more I have an idea whether people are falling asleep or not. tap it. Okay, given that this is the last session of the day and the pub is apparently opening in about 43 minutes, I think we can just start. This session is about improving usability of Drupal core for site builders and administrators. If you want to follow the slides or the notes directly, that's the link there. My name is Ifrik in the issue queue. Let's talk about usability. First of all, the question is, who's the user that we're actually talking about in this case? I like to talk about the site builders, the front enders, and the advanced administrators of the site when it's actually up and running. Because to me, that's the kind of professional users. It's the people that use Drupal both as a tool and a product. It's the site builders, the front enders, the administrators who really have to invest time into using Drupal or the Drupal site project that has been built afterwards, and it's also the people that take the decision about future projects. If you like Drupal, if you like the site you're working with, you're more likely to say, let's do this again. If it doesn't work for you, you might go for, let's try something different. But I also think if we help these three types of users, we're also helping the kind of first-time users and the kind of hobby users. So a site builder to me is somebody who actually build something that other people will use. It's the site builder is using Drupal both as a tool as well as a product they're building. The front-enders quite often are preparing the site to match the actual design. They are the kind of people that need to set up image styles, display modes, all of those kind of things. And the advanced administrators are the people that will actually be using the site later. It's the content editors. It's the people that approve of user accounts. It's the people that make sure that the commerce sites are still running. So based on that kind of criteria, any site builders in the room? Okay. any front enders? Any administrators of existing sites? Any developers of modules, of core? Any people who think I'd rather be in the pub by now? Okay. That was it. So why should we care about improving usability? First of all, I think it makes Drupal easier to use for us. It makes the sites that we build with Drupal much more easy to use. And it also contributes to much better accessibility. If you can get the usability right, then the step to have a good accessibility is also much smaller. And it's also actually freeing our time for building more interesting things. If as a site builder, I don't have to spend time to make, for example, the backend more accessible, more useful, I can actually focus on the interesting stuff that I'd like to actually build for clients. So what I'm talking about in this session is not about the nice new big functionalities that we get in Drupal core now, like the Unami theme or the out-of-the-box initiative or workflows, layout builders. I'm talking about the more small, gritty things that are still hanging around. So it's not about designing a new kitchen or developing a new fridge. It's turning about the fridge door around so that you stop banging your head because the door always opens to the wrong side. And I'm really irritated because I've got two screens here. So a bit about me. I'm a biologist actually by training. So I'm a scientist, I'm a scientific editor, a political activist. There's lots of grassroots experience. I'm a Drupal site builder, especially for small NGOs. I've worked with the documentation working group, and I'm now doing UX, much more UX. So I've basically moved from documenting things to explain others how things work or how they can use this to actually fixing the things. And I'll give you a few other people that are kind of representing Drupal as it is. I think you might. Some of you might all know of them, others not, so bear with me. Roy is one of the product managers, one of the core maintainers, when I ask him what he's doing, he says, I'm an illustrator by education, interaction designer by trade. In my contributions, I focus on visually clarifying the problem and suggesting possible solutions. And this enables people to agree on what to build next. So what he's doing as one of the core maintainers is not coding anything. Jenny, who also here, says, well, I just figured out how Drupal works through theming. And then I taught myself PHP to actually build the modules I need. She's actually giving a session on the Tasty backend module tomorrow, which is quite worth going to. Or informally, she said, actually, I just got into understanding Drupal by swearing a lot. Tim Millwood, maintainer of the node module and of the statistic module, and involved in the workflow initiative, was that I haven't built a Drupal site in years. So somebody who knows a very specific part of Drupal very well, but doesn't know much about the building a site with what he's built. Gabor, who actually did study computer science, is now much more involved in organizing things, like organizing Drupal Europe. Or Justine, who basically is currently learning about how Drupal works by reviewing the merge requests of our colleagues as a designer. So why am I telling you all of this? Because quite often we have this picture of this traditional picture of expertise when it comes to any software project or anything else, where we have the beginners at the bottom, the intermediates and the experts, or in terms of software, the user, then the kind of front-ender, and then developer, and that makes this magical thing at the top that really the only initiated understand. And I think in Drupal that doesn't actually work that way. In Drupal we have much more something like this, which is we have core development, we have contrib modules, we have documentation, we have event organizing to actually share this knowledge, design and theming, usability, accessibility, mentoring, translation, and also your specific project. And all of that feeds together into making Drupal what it is. All of that brings different kinds of expertise to make Drupal better, to make each version of Drupal better and more usable. So bearing that in mind, what can we improve at the moment? There's lots of fridge doors that we can deal with. The navigation, mainly the admin menu, what's where in the admin menu, permissions, field and fieldable entities, and UI text. So I'll give you a few examples on what are the kind of things that we can improve on the small day-to-day tasks that people are interacting with. So for the admin navigation, let me just give you a few examples. So where do I go to make a specific admin page visible for some user? Well, you first list all user accounts, and then you can go to the permissions. Or where do I go if I want to edit or translate a specific block, like the block with the opening times that are in the footer of a page? Well, first you go to the layout of the whole page, and then you can go to the content of the blocks. Or where do I go if I want to see media items? Well, you go to the content page that lists all the content, and then you go to the media items. So basically, we're continuously teaching users detours. We're not providing a consistent or predictable structure. We're telling them, you have to remember to go from, if you want to go from A to B, you have to remember to go to C first. As somebody who's been working with Drupal a lot, we can remember that. But the question is, do we actually want to teach that to our clients? And do we want to teach that to new users? Is that what we want to spend our time on? So there's a couple of issues that are covering these questions. Pretty much all of the points I raised actually have issues, and some of them are 9.5 years old by now. With this one, I have a specific other request, because Rachel and me have been looking at a way of restructuring the admin menu. For example, not having content blocks hidden under the structure of the block layout. But instead of doing yet another card sorting exercise, we're trying to see, can we have a set of maybe 7 guiding questions to know where everything should live? And to move that forward, we basically build a form where you can answer these questions. Like you can pick a page like the custom block library and say, does this belong here? Or does this have this or that on the page? And Rachel said, I should all tell you to bookmark it and go there, because if everybody just puts a few of these pages through this system, we'll see whether they end up on the same place. We'll see whether that works, because discussing it in the issue queue is very long and tedious. I'll come back to that link later. So, permissions and access. Any user who, for example, needs to edit the content of a blog can also remove every single blog from the page. If you want to edit the opening times of your shop at Christmas, you can remove the main content from the page. That's not something I want my user to stumble into, certainly not in the last day before a holiday or so. Any user who needs to edit a taxonomy term, for example, because you have free tagging and you want to get out a typing error or so, they can change the language of the vocabulary. Because all this that is just one permission. If you can edit a term, or if you can access those terms through the admin interface, you can also change you can change the name, you can change the language settings, you can mess up sites like that. And if you want to access a single structure page, for example, the custom block library, you get 10 configuration pages without any admin items. Any of those subsections under configuration will be there, no matter whether you have anything you can access there or not. That has been hanging around for 9 years and 7 months now, since it has been reported. It means that also, if I build a site for a user and I just want to let them just see the things I need to do, they still end up with these pages that they wonder about. And I would just like to be able to give them a site that just says, here are your 3 things or your 5 things or whatever. There isn't anything you don't need to be concerned with. But besides it being inconvenient, I also think that the lack of these more fine-tuned permissions can actually put the integrity of our sites at risk. If a user can accidentally remove the main content or mess up the menu because they change the language, that's confusing and it's messing up the site, and it means somebody else needs to come and fix it and hopefully remembers how the configuration was. Of course, our permission table is already really, really long. And I've been at projects where it was like, yeah, but if we need to sort that out, it's going to take another day, so we just leave it. There's only 3 users, they're going to be fine. But remember, you're looking at this long, long table once and sort it out. The users see the result of these permissions every single time they're using the site. So again, there's a few issues for that. For example, to have more granular block permissions or hide these empty admin categories. So a bit about user interface tags, because again, that's something where people will get, where people are interacting with the site and trying to find out what a specific page is doing. And sometimes these tags are really short, and you don't really, only if you already know what it does the text make sense. Sometimes the text is really long and too convoluted. But we also mainly end up with the problem that, this is a quote from a developer from DrupalCon in Vienna, said, I'm happy to sit down for 12 hours to write code, but I'm not going to spend 30 minutes to write a help text. And the reasons for that are actually, they're quite reasonable. I don't know where to put it. Does it should go on the help page? Should that go on the admin page? Should that be the long description under the field? It's too disconnected if it's on Drupal.org. I don't know where to find things there. I don't know whether anybody's even going to find whatever I write there, so I just don't bother. The question is also, for whom is this documentation, this help text? Are they for other developers? Are they for site builders? Are they for the end users later? We don't give any guidance to people, to any developers, on what kind of text is required where. Or also I'm not a writer, I'm not even a native English speaker, so I don't really know how to write this. So it leaves us with the question, who should write these UI texts? And after 10 years being involved with Drupal, it's like pretty much all of us, but as in a collaborative way of doing it together. Because on the one hand, I need the person who can tell me, what does this module actually do? I sometimes come undocumented functionality because nobody has figured out that there's this tick box or that this and this happens if you do this. But on the other hand, it also needs to be people who are who know what Drupal can do to find out how to describe this, but not the people who already know it inside out. Quite often you find that terms are used and the sentence makes sense except for you don't understand this first word and therefore you're just as lost as you were before. So I think we need to put more efforts into actually looking on these texts that are showing up on so many pages and find a way of dealing with that. And at the moment I haven't got a clue how to do this best. But yes, I think it's both the developers and the users, and also the feedback of users saying, I don't understand what I need to do here. Might be that they have not been paying attention, but it also might be just that it's just not clear enough. That this label that is so clear for you because you've been putting in the code for the last 6 months is just not clear. There is also work on to just redo the whole help system, but I didn't have enough time to actually look into that. Jennifer is working on that, so I think it's in good hands. But there's more help welcome on that issue as well. And then fields. I like fields. I've started using Drupal when it was 4.7, and I've seen flexi notes or adding fields. So Drupal 8 is this, wow. Pretty much everything is fieldable. I can now just, in the configuration, make so many different things. So you end up with, you have a taxonomy term, and which just has its name, its description, its parcelize, and then your colleague comes in, or your client comes in and says, can you just add a help text under this description? Just to make sure people know what to put in there. And can you just always expand that relation? Because all the terms there, in this case, will either go into fruit or vegetable. So we need that expanded. It shouldn't be collapsed. You think, yeah, great, fields. I can do that in 5 minutes. And you go there, and you look at managed fields. And neither the description nor the relations is a field. So you're already stuck there. And if you want to change the form display, well, you can say how many rows the description should have. But for example, you can't even change the position of this relation field, let alone say it should be expanded and not collapsed. So what you said, I do that in 5 minutes, it's like, a week later, and you're like, shit, what do I do now? Similar with the author and date field. You know, a note is by default displayed with submitted by username on date. And I think the first site I built, I tried to change that. That was the 4.7 site. I'm still stuck on this. How do I change this? But in this case, if your colleague comes and say, can we maybe say written by or author so-and-so, date so-and-so, and you're a bit more careful and you check, yes, they're actually fields, I should be able to do that. 5 minutes, no problem. Just except in this case, when you come to the managed display, there's no way of actually changing this. So even so, there are now fields, as far as I see that in the managed fields list, I can't change them in the display. So again, there actually is an issue for that to make sure that we can now just treat the author and the creation date as fields on our display. And then something which has become a bit of my pet project by now, fieldable menu items. If I understand it correctly, menu items are fieldable entities. Even so, some of them are created, for example, by views or so, and you can't really change the name or the path. But still, you can change things like whether they're enabled or disabled. You can, in the menu item configuration, you can still change the weight. But why can't I put an image on there? I mean, there aren't that many fields I would like to put on a menu item, but I would like to put images on menu items. And if you think that's an unreasonable request, that's Drupal core. That's hard-coded images on the menu items. Which means because I'm building a site for a client and I need another section in there, I need to then go into the 7 theme to put another icon in there instead of just having a field. this icon node. So I think there's lots of space where we can also improve on just making more accessible through the configuration to users. So who's responsible for all that usability? First of all, I think developers need to be aware of how what they're building is actually used, which is actually a step quite removed from what you're doing. The users actually need to raise issues. Users shouldn't be sitting there grumbling, saying, oh, this is really annoying. Oh, now I've lost 2 weeks because I can't actually do this. They actually need to raise the issue and say, I would like this functionality, or I think this doesn't work quite. So I think it's up to all of us to actually deal with usability issues. So this is not necessary usability testing with first-time users who don't know what a block is. We need usability testing with people who haven't working knowledge of Drupal to see how often you're actually clicking around to get to a certain page, for example, or where you're struggling, where you're actually starting to write custom code just to get that image where you want it. So it needs input from all of us. And especially because I think a better UX is for site builders, for front-enders, is also a better UX for the end users. Everything that works well for me as a site builder means I can pass on something to the end user that is more usable. Anytime I don't need to spend on getting lost or writing custom code or trying to find things means I can spend that on improving their specific usability needs on top of what we already have. So don't work around your grievances if you come across UX problems. Actually help us fix those issues in core. Make issues when you see them, review them, be clear about what the problem is. So get involved. I see some faces who are definitely involved, but even if you come across an issue, report it. If as a core maintainer you still don't know where the permissions are, which is one of the issues of Catch made, I think, a few years ago, make an issue. We can try to solve that. Attend sprints. That's a very good way, even for people with this very diverse experiences that I showed in the beginning. The designers, the users, the administrators. You can all come to a sprint and help working on these issues. You can review issues. You can say, yes, this patch actually works. It now does what I like it to do. Or you can say, yeah, this patch works, but not on my multilingual side. You can join the UX meetings. There's a UX meeting at 8:30 UK time every Tuesday evening, which is always announced in the UX Slack channel, where we just look at UX issues, about different initiatives, about small issues, about big issues. It's also recorded, so you can also watch it afterwards if you just want to get an idea first. And yes, give us some feedback on whether we can use these questions to sort out this admin structure. Thanks. That was a bit faster than intended, but... was on how much is of the UX problems I think is structural. I haven't actually assessed it in that kind of, but I think there's lots of underlying small structural problems that make it more difficult to, for example, the lack of permissions on blocks is the main reason why we haven't, there's an issue to move the blocks custom library out of blocks and under content, but that's still hanging on the fact that it needs different permissions. So the small step of moving the page, that's something that I as a site builder can do. But I can't, for example, fix that permission issue. So it's more that these kind of things are intertangled and that every time you think, that's a quick fix, that's a quick win, we can make that better, you find yourself going down this rabbit hole. So that's why also we need really good descriptions of what is the problem. What are we trying to fix? And then finding a way of doing that step by step.
how do you feel your success rate, or not the new X, the people looking at issues like this, how do you feel your success rate is at the moment? How much do you feel you're actually achieving and improving as you go along? And how much do you feel you're logging a lot of issues that are problematic and not necessarily getting fixes through to court?
Mm-hmm. Until a few years ago, I think usability was just kind of a random tag that was showing up. And therefore, when usability issues were logged, they didn't really get noticed that much. Since we now have these regular meetings and look at usability issues, it becomes more worthwhile actually reporting them. So because we look at usability issues, those kind of issues come up, those kind of issues are raised, which means it looks like there's never growing number. Sometimes the changes are small. There was one issue in there where in the early Drupal 8 versions, when you looked at the content table, it had three filters, but the filters were in a different order than the columns underneath. And I realized at some stage that with every single site I built, I moved these columns around, or these filters around. That's now fixed. So that's a very small fix that probably goes completely unnoticed unless you realize that you don't have to do this anymore. There's a few other things where I think they will go unnoticed. Other things, like changing the admin structure, moving the custom logs library, for example, will be more disruptive. So I'm not quite sure what the success rate is. I mean, it would be great to have only a few issues in the with the usability text that all say RTBC, but that could also mean that nobody actually bothers reporting something. So it's difficult to say what the success rate is. But having these meetings already gives that input, let's focus on it.
How do you structure your issues? Do you kind of give them, for example, easy fixes, difficult? Because to an organization, if you, like people or you could just say, you know, these should be easy fixes.
On Drupal.org, you can tag issues with novice issues, for example. Again, that depends on what the actual expertise of the user is, whether this is really a novice issue or not. For me, as a scientific writer, editing a text is something I can do late at night without too much thinking. But that's because I have years of training with that. Changing something in PHP, to me, is somewhere there. But for other people, issues that for me are really okay, I don't even know where to start, can be an easy fix. So again, it depends on what your expertise is. But we definitely have novice issues that are especially taken up with the mentored sprints of telling people, okay, this is an issue that hopefully can be done in a day, that where you don't need to understand the whole legacy of Drupal and inside out and everything. I don't know, and that's actually the only one where I haven't actually made an issue yet. But I see you shaking your head there.
The Minga system is interesting in code, and I think that would actually not be possible in the current architecture. So, yes, it would be really nice, and I think treating all these menu links being the same would be nice, but they aren't the same right now. That's why we can't actually add fields to those.
But can't I add fields to them no matter whether they're created there or coming from somewhere else?
Yeah, that's exactly the thing. If you create menu links manually using the user interface, they are content entities.
Mm-hmm.
If they are coming from views, or if they're coming from YAML files and modules, they aren't. And that's why they are different. And just the ones which are content, and because content is based upon fields and everything, you can just add it to the manual create ones right now. But yeah, I can be nice.
Mm-hmm.
I feel it's more like a denial.
So that's what I mean with the, to me, as a user, as a site builder, that looks like a simple issue. Then you asked. There was another, sorry.
I have another question. So you talked about small improvements, which are really nice. But do you also have like a vision for like, let's say like long term?
To me, actually, getting rid of these small gritty things is very much a long-term structure. I'm not the kind of person who will fix the small things before building something big and new. I'm the kind of person who makes sure that all the wallpaper is off the wall before you start painting it new. There's certainly other people who like the kind of starting from scratch, doing a completely new functionality. And I think that's great as well. But I think we really need to deal with getting some of these legacy problems out of the way, because otherwise we're just dragging them along and we end up just kind of trying to work around and around them. So I would like to kind of clear those up and be able to work on that basis. So to me, that's a long-term goal that I would like to. I would like to have not a single issue in Drupal 8 that was raised in Drupal 6. Sorry.
There's an answer for that. Well, the crisis
is the more. Well, then I will still reopen one and say, can we get rid of these empty admin sections? So, unfortunately, or fortunately for us, so we can just make new issues.
Mm-hmm. The best place to report issues in the main Drupal core issue queue or in the contrib issue queue?
In the what's core? Yeah, should go into the core issue queue. That's under Drupal project Drupal.
There's a category drop down there, isn't there, for bug reports or code feature requests?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, if you say it's usability or needs usability review, for example, then you put that in the tags. And it really helps to actually describe the issue well. I don't know whether you're all aware of when you put in an issue, you can actually put in this kind of template to say, what's the problem? How would I like this to be fixed? Because quite often, when you see an issue, it might not be clear what people actually want or envision. So you try fixing it in a way that you think is fit. That's no matter whether that's Drupal core or whether that's your client work. If you don't quite understand what the problem is, you might come up with a solution that doesn't actually fit. Or if you know what the problem is, you might actually come up with a different solution that addresses that problem. We had a situation where in a social space with a small bar, we had a fridge. And that had lots of bottles of beer in it. And people said we had too much beer because they couldn't find the bottles when people asked for them. So instead of reducing the number of beers, we just got a different fridge that has a glass door and light. Now we have twice as much beer. So in that case, the question was not we have too much beer. The problem was I can't find the beer that somebody's asking for. And if we can make issues that are clear on what people want to achieve, I think then we can also solve them better, and especially for code, we have to see whether it works or not. And we have coding standards we can test on. For usability, it's much more difficult to know whether something works or works as intended, but the intention didn't fit the user's needs. And so.
Because there's thousands of issues on it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the point where you also need to do the social engineering, the actually raising the issue, like not only putting it in there, but possibly also talking to somebody or trying to get starting on it and then ask. And anything that's tagged with needs usability review ever so often is getting checked or looked at by the UX meeting on Tuesdays. So if you got to that point, it has a Slack channel. Unfortunately, the IRC channel got abandoned, but on the Drupal Slack, there's a channel called Usability, or UX, I think Usability. And on Tuesday evenings, you will see that either Gabor or Roy pops up about half an hour before and says, is there any issues that we should talk about? And then by 8:30, there will be a group of four, or five, six people who will actually say, okay, these are the issues we're going to discuss today. So yeah, being in that channel, saying a while, and if you say a while beforehand that you have an issue you want to discuss, you'll also usually get pinged on saying that whether you're around for the meeting. So you'll see your IRC client or your Slack client beeping or whatever is set up for you. Mm-hmm. But yes. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Yeah. You talked about passing on benefits to administrators.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say something about how far the shortcut system goes towards that?
I think shortcuts should be something where you can get faster to something that you can actually already get to. So shortcut, to me, shortcuts should be something that I can set up for a specific site for the, okay, these are the main tasks that needs doing, or these are the pages I go to quite often as the individual user, while my colleague might need to go to other pages quite often. So I think shortcuts are an added bonus, something that is individual. It shouldn't be that shouldn't be holding the main, like the relevant structures. So if we can move, for example, the content, the custom block library into content, you could still add a shortcut to that if that's something you use often. But you still should be able to get to it through the main menu. So yeah, to me, shortcuts is more like it's your personal things of, they're more personal, less generally, structurally, to me. I know that the add content link is in under shortcuts, but we do have an issue that is quite far by now to actually add something in the menu bar to add all types of content and media and directly, so that we don't need to use shortcuts for that either. Any other questions? Any other usability issues that you have or would like to add to the list?
Mine's about the pub, so you can save me on last.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so any usability questions that cannot be discussed over a beer? Okay, thanks. Back in there, so.
Maybe. I think Tristan will come back in and check it. Mm-hmm. I feel like I did your session last year because I recognized you, and then I saw your Twitter handle, but I definitely recognize that handle.
Did you do a session
last year?
No, I don't think so.
I don't even check.
But I have done this session before, I think. I've done session at other places.
Last one was my first Drupal cab.
All right.
I do a lot of the content stuff locally. So I do like agile content.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely run into your head a little more. So hopefully not because you're causing trouble. Well, they just sent us an urgent thing saying our quotes will be locked in. So I have to go.
Oh, yes. I need to get mine as well then.
Are you in the...
No, in the cloak room.
I think you guys have a good one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then like in my app, and then I rewrite the
text. Welcome.
And then like give the permission, and then this doesn't exist in my app, so it forms to.
I don't think that the Unami theme has actually dealt with any of the usability issues, at least not from on the kind of, at least not on the site builders end. they are looking at making everything really accessible. So that's something that can probably also go into the other themes, if there's anything else. I think it's really good to have this additional, but yeah, so we just need to make sure that we are not kind of building something on shifting sand.
That's the thing is that, I think what Sally suggesting is like, okay, just looking at my best is there on the camera, so what I want, what we want is a helper module that goes in and answers the request, and then you can then react to that as a preview for the helper, which is a work product.
There are some things that are getting built straight away into core, like the, for the workflow, they had already been experienced, but it's more fine to take that experience, but still building it fresh into core. So I think that's a pretty good approach, if there's enough, there's this whole Drupal ideas queue, where people can put forward ideas before they start working on things. So, I think implicitly it has, because like Webchick is somebody who's also at the weekly UX calls. So ideas that are looked at by the ideas people like Webchick and Roy and Gabor are also issues that, so yeah, they are aware of the usability issues. But sometimes it's also like, I remember one issue that I was just kind of, there was a patch coming by and I said, oh, I should review it. I don't really have time. I just make a branch on this project that I'm working on and chuck it in there, which is when I realized that it completely doesn't work on a multilingual site. But when you test things, usually they're more compartmentalized. You're just doing it on a fresh install. So actually having these bigger initiatives that are really trying to integrate with core from the beginning on is, I think, a good idea.
Just internally, it was interesting to hear some of the perspective of some of the things that we've been doing developers extracting them from some process and brief them properly. So it's not sort of saying, oh, they're aware of it, but making sure that they don't sort of build stuff from scratch.
Leeds.